Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah. Rogers, how different has this year been game planning defensively without Coach Schwartz?
Honestly, it hasn't been much different. I think that the way we prepare as coaches, as a staff, just kind of our breakdowns and the analytics and all of the numbers we use and just going over our normal principles of defense, it's kind of been very much similar. I think that the reason that we've kind of had a uptick in production is you got guys that, you know, are in their fourth year doing this, and you got some other guys that are eager to reach that level, and that standard has been set for us as a program defensively. And it's been fun. I think it's a new challenge every game to just kind of keep on continuing to just be extremely dominant as possible. And we've been able to do it. It's been fun to watch.
Is it a shared responsibility in terms of the defense? In terms of
yeah, you know, I think Coach Ganey takes a lot of that. He's done a great job in the transition from Coach Schwartz to him, and is kind of keeping on and continuing to hammer away at our principles and also change some things up as well. He's done a really good job with that. But I think for each game, it doesn't even matter. Sometimes, you know, guys have scouts, but we all kind of chip in and kind of help with our game planning as such for the next opponent. You know, we do a good job of all kind of staying on top of that.
Is it surprised at all that the defense has been this dominant given Josiah has been in and out of the lineup?
I think it's surprising of some of the new guys catching on so fast. Like Julian's done a great job of kind of, you know, upping his intensity on that end. Tyree Key's done an unbelievable job. And, you know, I think that the guy that is the reason that our defense has reached the level it has is the, you know, the growth of Jonas Aidoo. Like, that's been the biggest difference to me is Jonas. He's been incredible. Basically, you take the same defense we had last year. You know, we have the same gap principles. We pull over to the ball. We're heavy load up. And now you put a guy that basically puts a lid on top of the rim. And, I mean, that makes the number one defense in the country.
Had he shown enough in practice that you expected him to make this jump that he has?
He had shown a lot of growth, but I think for a lot of these guys, when the lights come on is when you really are able to see what that transition was like from freshman to sophomore year, whatever growth process it was. He showed some of it, but, I mean, the things he's been able to do in these games, it's been great to watch. It's really been incredible. It's been great.
Specifically for Jonas, at what point do you realize they go from overthinking it and thinking about every move they're making on defense to where it becomes a natural thing that they're doing?
You know, I think that especially for someone like Jonas, it comes from playing against guys, you know? Like when Jonas first got here last year in the summer, I remember him saying it was the first time he consistently played against college guys. And, you know, I used to joke with him about it because I'm like, man, you're from Durham, North Carolina. Like, you got every school in the country down the street. You never played against college guys? And he's like, no. And so, you know, when you go against Uros, who's 7 foot, 260 pounds, and you go against Olivier Kamwa and John Fulkerson and all these guys for, you know, 2 years now, like you start to pick up on some things. You start to understand habits. You start to understand angles. And he's done an excellent job of just kind of catching up and picking up on those things and kind of putting them on the game space.
What have you guys done as a staff to motivate guys to buy in to what y'all are doing defensively?
Show them championship rings from last year. Just kind of showing them scores from last year. Obviously, I think that the proof is like, hey, it works. And then, you know, when you have dominant performances and guys see how fun it is to dominate teams on the defensive end, I think that it kind of becomes a thing in the locker room where it's like, let's see how much we can hold this team to. Or, you know, we set goals like last game. We set a goal of, you know, we wanted to hold the team. We wanted to hold McNeese to 50 points or lower. And so obviously we go into halftime with score how it was, and then coach is like, well, let's try to do 35. And it's like, come on, coach. Like, relax a little bit. but it's fun because the guys, they think of it in their minds, and it's a mental note, and they hold each other accountable as far as locking in on that end of the floor. So it's been great.
How important are these few games here for guys like BJ and Tobey in terms of their development?
They're huge. They're huge. You know, I think last game after shoot around, I kind of just spoke to the guys a little bit, and we were talking about it as coaches, where it's like, it's great that we love to perform when the lights are the biggest, and, you know, we the you know, the performance we had defensively against Kansas was great, but like every game has to be like that. You know, we have something to prove. It's a statement game every time we walk out. And part of having a mature team is that we can't take any opponent lighter than the other. Like, no game is less important than the next. Like, we kind of really have to lock in on even, you know, the teams that come through here that people consider bye games. Like, they're not bye games, they're real games. And those young guys really need the experience of getting on the floor and seeing what this is like, because, you know, you sitting and watching us play against, you know, playing in the Battle for Atlantis and playing against these high level games, and sometimes they're not quite ready for that. They're still growing. But then you get in these games where they should be ready, and they get in, and it's still something new that they learn every time. So these are the games that our older guys are supposed to, they're supposed to come out and have a great effort and play really well, and then give time for those guys to come on the floor and hopefully contribute to winning.
What's the difference in Jamai player now compared to last season?
Night and day. I mean, it's night and day. He's become a better shooter. He's become a better ball handler. He's become a better decision maker. He's become someone that coach feels like he could check in the game and won't have to like rip his hair out at some point. You know what I mean? He was a flight risk at times last year. He really was. He was scary when he had the ball in his hands. But now he's just matured. He's understanding the game. Things have slowed down for him. And the work he put in over the summer is definitely been shown. So I think he's another guy. His maturation process was different. It was slower than others, but it's worked out, because now he's someone that we depend upon every game to come in, get big stops, guard the other team's best player, make open shots, bring that toughness and that edge that we need as a team.
He's talked to us about understanding he's not the number one offensive scorer on this team. What's right. The balance of that and not being a liability offensively and still searching your shots and your spots on the floor?
Yeah, I think for him it was more and more reps, just kind of seeing that, you know, and he's been a great teacher for the younger guys, understanding when, you know, everybody on this team was a good scorer in high school. Everybody had a lot of scoring opportunities and offensive advantages at the high school level. When you come to college, you kind of have to find your niche. You have to find your role. You have to fit in. And this team is the definition of fitting in, whether it be on either side of the ball. So his identity has been created as a defensive catalyst, and he's done a great job at embracing that and just kind of riding that out and being a spearhead guy of essentially one of the best defenses in the country. So.
When those young guys get in late in these games, how big of an adjustment is it for them to think, Rick doesn't care what I do on the offensive end, he's only going to care what I do on the defensive end?
Yeah, it's big. It's big. I actually had a conversation with, you know, BJ the other day. Tobey, obviously, he got in last game, got scored on the first possession, and coach ripped him right out. Those guys got to understand that, again, the standard has been set, and it's been set by those older guys, and it's great. But there's going to come a time when those older guys aren't here and they're going to be responsible for setting that standard. So they have to understand, like, guys going to guard. Like, that's just what's going to happen here in Tennessee. We tell guys that during recruiting. We tell guys that when they get on campus. Like, they're going to guard. And if they don't, it's just going to be really hard to play here. So that just comes from competing and just having a will to win.
What city has the best barbecue in the country, North Carolina, Memphis, or Texas?
Just so you know. That's how you know I've been working for Rick Barnes. I'm from Kansas City, Missouri. We have two guys from North Carolina on this staff, and they always try to gang up against me. Luckily, Coach Polinski's here. He's from St. Louis, so he understands. Kansas City, Missouri has the best barbecue in the country. It's not even close. North Carolina barbecue is not very good. They use vinegar. They don't use a lot of sauce. It's just not even close. I just want everybody to know that, please.
Is it true that you took Rick to a barbecue restaurant in Kansas City and got a burger?
That's no. That doesn't even sound like anything I do. And I know he likes to keep that
going.
No, I did not. Sources say, I actually did not. And I took him to the tourist barbecue spot because I didn't think he would appreciate the real barbecue in Kansas City.
Joe's?
Huh?
Joe's?
I took him to Jack Stack. Okay. Yeah, I didn't take him to Gates. He wouldn't appreciate it. I didn't want him disrespecting the barbecue of my home state. So I didn't do that.